All right, we are now live.
Hi, everyone that's coming in. Hey, everyone. I hope you guys are doing well. If you guys can put down into the chat where you guys are kind of what city and state you guys are representing, I think that that will be kind of cool. Hi, Bridget. Hi, Catherine. Hi, Joyce. Maggie. All right, you guys. It's about 1:01. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen in a little bit, and then we'll go ahead and get started. Angela? Anything Hello. With you?
Yeah, I just wanted to say welcome to everyone. We're so excited that you're able to make this webinar. So I must tell you, we have people from literally all different time zones who are here. So I'm going to say good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everybody from all the different time zones. We're happy you could make it.
Awesome. Oregon, Cleveland, Idaho, New York, love it. I'm just here from little old Virginia.
California over here.
Love it. All right. All right, you guys, we got about half the participants that we know that signed up. I am going to go ahead and share my screen with you guys. All right. So today, December 7th, we'll be starting off our talk, Let's Talk, Open Conversations for Women with Alopecia. This is our episode number 4, and we're talking about Own Your Beauty, tips on makeup, wigs, and more. So again, I am Dr. Renee Thomason, my co-host, Dr. Angela Rogers. You'll be hearing from her in just a little bit. We just kind of put together this webinar series back in early fall to where we just saw a need in the alopecia community. And we just started Let's Chat, just these open conversations so that we can talk about things just to basically help our community. We did a survey previously. And so today is really just kind of an accumulation just of everything. And we got a lot of experts to really kind of answer a lot of your questions. So I first wanted to kind of start off just kind of sharing a little bit just personally, what does the definition of beauty mean to me and to Angela, and the reason why we just are passionate about this today. So if I'm thinking about my definition of beauty before and after my diagnosis of alopecia, it can mean so many different things. I was diagnosed at a young age, at 8 years old, so I really didn't know what beauty meant to me. It was really, you know, oh, your parents telling you, oh, you're the cutest little thing, or your aunts or your uncles or anything like that. After I was diagnosed with alopecia, when I had a bunch of spots and I had my hair and stuff that was shedding, I wouldn't say that I felt ugly or anything like that. I just know that I just felt different. I felt awkward. I just never felt like any of my other peers. So I never essentially felt that I was ugly or anything like that. I just didn't just feel normal. As it progressed, I guess, kind of like into my adulthood to where I am now, I would say that my definition of beauty would really just be acceptance. Acceptance with my disease of alopecia and just kind of the journey that comes along with it, and just knowing that I am beautiful just the way that God created me to be. So that would be my definition of what beauty means to me. Angela, what would yours be?
Yeah, so thank you for sharing that, Renee. So to me, I very clearly remember my definition of beauty was my hair. so you can imagine when I lost it, I definitely had to change my definition. Mm-hmm. And it was hard. It was really hard. I feel like I went to therapy for a few years. I'm still in therapy currently, and I feel like that helped a lot. And I personally came to realize that what I thought before was beauty, namely hair and comparison to other people. I came to realize that beauty is not a comparison. Beauty is who you are, what you are. And it can change. It can change with time. I think I'm an example of that. I just want to encourage everybody out there that society teaches you there is only one form of what beauty is, and that's not true. And so I want to make sure that is very clear. I also wanted to mention a couple of Zoom housekeeping things, if Renee is okay with that.
Yeah.
So I just want to remind everyone, please stay muted, just so we can hear all of our wonderful guest speakers. I wanted to remind you that this session will be recorded. So, you know, it's okay if you are not able to stay the entire session. We will be doing a Q&A session at the end where we will ask you to type your questions into the chat. And then we will ask myself and Renee as the moderators, we will ask the questions to our guest speakers. And once again, we are excited for you all to be here today. So that's it for me.
Okay. All right. So today, you guys, we have a wonderful lineup. We will have makeup and skincare with Kimberly Carey, also Dr. Sven Gunter. We will be discussing wig care and style with Tony Malone and also Yaz Gomez Lopez. And also just a touch of just inspiration and just everything with the lovely Ebony Jean. So we can go ahead and get started. Angela, you want to introduce Ben?
Yes, I would love to. It would be my pleasure. So Dr. Sven Gunter, he is a plastic surgery resident currently at Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland, Ohio. He is extremely passionate about plastic surgery, especially skincare and the integration of medicine into our daily lives. Dr. Gunter created a successful educational blog entitled Plastic Surgeon Dreaming, which is really awesome. You have to check it out. And this blog basically teaches not only what works, but also how and why it works, the medicine behind it, and basically gives some pointers on how to make informed decisions based on his experiences and background in science and medicine. He is also one of my old medical school classmates. So very excited to show this video to you all. I just wanted to have Dr. Gunter say hi to you, and then I'm gonna go ahead and start the video that he recorded. Dr. Gunter?
Hello, everyone. Thank you again for the opportunity to present. Obviously, the presentation is kind of just a short sort of recap of the medicine and kind of an overview of it. If you do have any other deeper questions, feel free to contact me or take a look at my website for kind of more information.
Wonderful. I'm gonna ask that everybody turn their volume up to the max, just so you can clearly hear the video. And again, everyone to mute themselves. I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen.
Hi, my name is Dr. Sven Gunter. I'm finishing up my plastic surgery residency at Case Western Reserve University. I have a bachelor's in cell biology and biochemistry, as well as a master's in clinical research. So skincare is one of my passions, both as in plastic surgery and for myself. And it is a passion of mine to kind of break down the science of skincare, read the articles, and then kind of make that something easy that I can tell to family, friends, and also my patients to kind of give them answers on how to take care of their skin. So kind of the basics of skincare to kind of give you where we're going. I like to think of it, skincare as a lifestyle. It should be something that you do every day. Doesn't necessarily need to be something that's expensive. I like to think of skincare as, if you're looking for quality products, you know what to look for in a skincare. It can be found in simple things in over the counter or even at your local pharmacies. I encourage people to always experiment with new things, but only to change one thing at a time. So if you don't have a good reaction to that one thing, you know that it was that one thing that you changed. And it should be fun. Obviously, it's your skincare, it's your body, and taking care of yourself should be something that you also enjoy. So starting with the skin. So the skin is the largest organ of the body. It basically protects your underlying organs and underlying tissues and structures, nerves, arteries, veins, bones, and tendons, while also regulating the temperature, both with dilating of blood vessels through sweat production. Looking at the anatomy, skin has many layers. The epidermis is kind of the thinner outside area. This protects the underlying skin cells. It's also where your melanocytes are. And then underneath the dermis, the epidermis is the dermis, where protein structures of support can be found. These are the collagen, elastin. It's also where your sweat and oil. So if there's one thing that I can tell you to take away from this presentation is protection against the sun. Sunscreen, sunblock, suntan lotion, whatever you want to call it, is the number one best thing that you can do for your skin. Basically, the sun has UV light, UV radiation. This directly decreases the production of collagen and elastin. Collagen and elastin are the things that cause plumpness, youthfulness to the skin, and without that, it can lead to skin aging. Sun also increases production of the proteins that degrade, so even though you make less of the collagen and elastin, the sun also increases metalloproteinases, collagenases. Those are the things that eat up those proteins. Obviously, UV light also damages DNA, which leads to skin cancer. Now, obviously, darker skin tones do have more protection against the sun with the melanin in your skin. However, I like to tell everyone gets wrinkles. So even though you have more protection, protecting your skin against the sun is the number one thing that you can do for youthful-looking skin. So kind of what to look for. Obviously, you've all heard of SPF, which stands for sun protection factor. I recommend a SPF of around 30, which gives the minimum protection at about 97% of UVB radiation. UVB radiation is the one that goes to the more shallow. This is the one that burns. Now, the SPF is a multiplying factor. So for instance, if I get a sunburn in 10 minutes without any sun protection, an SPF of 30 gives me 30 times that, so 300 minutes until I would essentially get the same amount of burn. Obviously that's used as directed. When looking for a sunscreen, it's also really important to look for something called broad spectrum. This means it will not only protect against the UVB, but also protect against UVA, which is a more deeply penetrating. And just to let you know that both UVA and UVB both can cause damage to your DNA, obviously cancer. You can also do behavior modifications, so staying out of sun during peak hours of the day, seeking shade when you do need to be out in the sun, and obviously protective clothing, hats, visors, long sleeve shirts, etc. Can all work together to protect you from the sun. When looking for the sunscreen, there's several different kinds. One of the categories would be a chemical type of sunscreen. Basically, these work by absorbing the UV radiation, trapping it, and then converting it into heat. The pros of that is it's very effective when used properly. Typically, it's more inexpensive. It's the most commonly sort of seen variety of sunscreen that you see in kind of the stores. The cons of it, so the chemical sunscreens, they need to be reapplied, so make sure to read the instructions on the back. If it needs to be reapplied every 2 hours, it needs to be applied after getting in and out of the water, for example, You need to follow those directions in order to maintain that SPF that it says. They may not cover or minimally cover UVA, so make sure to look for that broad spectrum on the packaging as well. And like I always like to tell people, this one needs to be reapplied, so it's just not one that you put on once and then you're done. Another category is the barrier, the reflective, or the mineral type sunscreen. These sunscreens work by, as the name implies, by basically reflecting instead of absorbing the UV light. These products usually have aluminum, zinc, or titanium in them that does reflect the sun rays. Pros of that is it doesn't need to be reapplied unless it's wiped off in some sort of way. Typically, these formulations are less greasy, and they reflect, obviously, both UVA and UVB. They're like little mirrors kind of on your face. The cons of it is they tend to be a little bit more expensive, a little bit harder to find, and they can sometimes leave a white film on the skin, which can sometimes be visible in those that have more pigmentation to their skin. There are varieties that do have a little bit more pigment in them or have smaller particle sizes that are better for that, but that is one of the cons of this type of sunscreen. So, kind of starting from the beginning, face wash, very simple. You should be something that's simple, something that's gentle. Obviously, the goals of washing your face is to just wash up the dirt and grime of kind of your day-to-day living. I prefer a cleanser or non-soap soap formulas, I think are best. They're a little bit more gentle. Something that's non-comedogenic, which basically means doesn't clog your pores, cause blackheads. And any cleanser that you use shouldn't leave your face feeling dry or afterwards. Obviously, you want to keep some of the oils in your skin. Try to avoid things with fragrances, as that can cause skin sensitivity. And if you're looking for more exfoliation, natural exfoliation is best. Some can even have some salicylic acid. Those can be used for those that have acne-prone skin. Kind of pro moves. Washing your face in the morning and in the evening. Try not to touch your face during the day. Wash your bed linens at least weekly. Remember, those are things that you touch your skin. And then kind of in the age of COVID, so either washing, if you use a fabric mask, washing the mask frequently. I prefer the daily one-time use paper masks personally. Talking about toning. So toning is a liquid that can be applied after the face is washed. Typically, it's used to decrease oiliness, diminish the appearance of pores, hydrate or soothe the skin. It's kind of the touch-up effect of skincare. There are many different kinds. There are the alcohol-based toners. I would say avoid these. Basically, those are used for removing oils from your skin. And like I said, if you have a good cleanser, you want to keep some of those oils. You don't want to completely devoid your skin of its own oils. There are the oil-containing toners. These are can work as topical antifungals or antibacteria. Some can cause rashes, so just kind of be aware of that as well. I think tea tree oil gets special mention. It has studies showing improvement with those that have acne-prone skin. Another category is the acid-based toners. These are gentle chemical exfoliators, can help with unclogging pores, removing blackheads, improving acne. Kind of the old school witch hazel is actually in this category. It's gallic acid to help kind of gently exfoliate. Salicylic acid is also in that category, and my personal favorite is glycol. So on selecting kind of a protective lotion or a cream, it can be many times just in your sun protection or in your makeup. Two birds, one stone, we all have busy lives. It's nice to have something that is quick and easy. Some will have vitamin C or acetic acid. There are limited good quality studies that have available, but a few that show some improvement in wrinkles, skin pigmentation, an increased amount of collagen in them. Niacinamide is a form of vitamin B3. There have been studies looking at topical niacinamide in the improvement of wrinkles, skin tone, and elasticity. Just a word of caution: you cannot use niacinamide with vitamin C. They don't play nice together, and it actually is deactivated by vitamin C. Hyaluronic acid is also commonly seen. There are studies that show topical hyaluronic acid showing improvement in skin hydration and elasticity. Some like to mention that it's absorbed through the skin, but it's a large protein that basically won't be absorbed through the skin, but it can help with hydration. Picking a night cream, typically they end up being kind of thicker than your day cream. It's a good time for getting added hydration of your skin. Can look for very similar ingredients to those found in your day cream. So kind of after this, you kind of get into kind of the next level of skincare. So tretinoin. So basically tretinoin is a prescription drug, topical cream. It's a derivative of a vitamin A, similar to retin A, but much more potent. It basically works on the cellular level to actually change the way that your skin functions. It's the only thing that can reverse damage from the sun, increase collagen production, decrease dyspigmentation, decrease acne, and improve fine lines and wrinkles. Kind of secondary to sunscreen, this is something that can really, really change your skin. However, it does come at a price. It is a prescription that's typically needs to be prescribed by your doctor and followed by your doctor as well. It's typically not covered by insurance. It's not terribly expensive. A tube for me, I can purchase for about $100, lasts me about 2 years. It is a lifestyle, so it is something that needs to be applied usually daily or every other day. Can only be used at night, because sun will deactivate it. It does lead to sun sensitivity, so sunscreen is a must. And there is an adjustment period of about 6 weeks when starting it that has redness, kind of swelling, skin peeling, that can be a little bit unpleasant. But once your skin gets used to it, those reactions go away. Full effects kind of take 4 to 6 months to kind of kick in. So it is one of those things that is an investment that can take. I always like to talk about microblading in this. I know that it's become more popular as well. With microblading, which is tattooing. Basically, it's very shallow tattoos done with small cuts, usually in the eyebrows, eyebrow areas to mimic fuller eyebrows or to make the appearance of kind of hair-like strokes, where the pigment is basically rubbed into those and those heal. Since they are shallow tattoos, you want to avoid use of chemical peels or acid toners. Those increase cell turnover and therefore will move the tattooing pigment out of the skin. Remember, vitamin C is an acid, so be kind of aware of that as well. You want to avoid use of tretinoin or other vitamin A products like retin A on the specific areas that have the microblading. These two increase cell turnover. When you plan on getting microblading, you'll want to stop tretinoin for a few weeks before you get the microblading, because it can lead to a little bit of increased bleeding, which can diminish your results when you get the microblading or get your touch-ups as well. Sunscreen obviously is a must. It will increase the longevity of your microblading, but you're going to wear sunscreen anyway after this talk. So kind of in summary, similar to how we started, skincare should be fun. Select stuff that works for you. Something works for one of your friends or someone that you talk to, it may not be ideal for you. We all have different skin. Make it a habit. Make it something that you can do every day that won't be too hard and something that it becomes seamless and just part of your life. Like I said, sunscreen, sunscreen, sunscreen. It is the best thing that you can do. Find a way to get sunscreen into your life, one that works for you, one that you can use every single day. only change one thing at a time and make sure that it works with your skin. You hear a lot of the people starting a ton of new things on their skin and they have a skin reaction. Well, you don't know exactly what that skin reaction was to unless you change only one thing at a time. If you use something that doesn't work for you, switch to something else. Focus on ingredients. Just because you spend more money doesn't necessarily mean that you're getting a better product. Many of the very common ingredients that I talked about today are found in your over-the-counter at the drugstore skincare areas. So it's definitely possible. It does not have to be something that is prohibitively expensive. Thank you for the opportunity to let me talk. Obviously, this is a very short talk. If you want any more information about skincare, I do have skincare or a plastic surgery. I do have a blog at plasticsurgeondreaming.com. I have a QR code here if you'd like to use that. Again, thank you for your time and take care.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Dr. Gunther. I really appreciate it. You guys, we will have a Q&A session with him towards the end. So again, if you guys have any questions about skincare or anything else, please be sure to put it in the chat and we'll have a whole session with Dr. Gunther after everything. So next, let's get into makeup. We are going to start with Kimberly Carey. Kimberly is a multicultural makeup artist and currently lives in Abu Dhabi. Girl, you go ahead. She is the proud owner of Heavenly Reflection Makeup and K. Nicole, the brand. Kimberly lives her life as a school teacher by day and a makeup artist by night. Love it. She is a model, alopecia awareness advocate. She's also a confidence coach, MC, and transformational speaker by night. I don't know why I'm fumbling, but I'm sorry. So anyhow, Kimberly, we will turn everything over to you.
Okay, well, first things first, good evening, everyone, because it is officially or almost 10:30 at night here in Abu Dhabi, and I'm not well past my bedtime, so I think we're okay on that one. So a little bit about me and how I ended up where I am. I actually started losing my hair at 19. And as Dr. Angela, we were talking about earlier, it's like adulthood. It's like things just started happening in adulthood. And it's like, well, where did this happen? Where did this come from? Bottom line, let's fast forward to 20 years, almost 12 years, sorry. This is where I am now. I'm 41 now, so I know black don't crack. But I think that's as a result of not having hair. I think if I had hair and had all the open pores and all those other things, I think I would have aged a little bit quicker. But anyway, the point of the matter is when I was 32, that's when I moved here. That's when I moved to Abu Dhabi. So prior to that and living in the United States, I had spent a majority of my time hiding behind wigs, hiding behind hats, hiding behind scarves and feeling as if it was a necessity. Now, I understand that we all have a journey and a lot of people would tell me to my face, oh, you are so pretty. You should just go ahead and wear your hair, wear your head, be proud of your head. And it's like, you're not me, you don't know me. So this is my journey. And one thing I can say before I start talking about makeup in any way, makeup here, is that you need to make up here. And that was one thing that I had to really come to grips with when I was 32. When I moved here. And when I moved here, when I tell you that me showing up on the scene as a bald woman was a wake-up call to these people. This is the Middle East. Okay, this is the land of hair and honey. This is the place where they have an actual hair dance, where they dance and they celebrate their hair. But when I came on the scene, it was like, oh my gosh, you'll never get married. You'll never find a man. No one will ever love you. All of these other things, and to my face, not behind my back. So something happened in me And it was, I don't know everyone's spiritual journey, but God came in me and he said, you know what, you are created in my image. And I have many images right now. And at this phase in your life, guess what? You're bald. That's exactly how it happened. And one day it was like, well, why not? Create your own standard of beauty. Why not you? Why can't you just be the bald lady? Everybody else has hair down to their ankles and to their heels. Why can't you be the bald lady? It's okay. It's okay. And why not show them something new? Show them what it can look like. Show them that you don't have to hold your head down because you don't have hair. Here, it's a totally different story. So when I walk out, I do shock people, but I do give them something to look at the same time. Now, when I moved here, like I was saying, I was coming to grips with this, coming to grips with this as well. But I was like, I can't control this. So what can I control? Now, Middle Eastern women, Arab women are very, very much about their makeup. And they may be crumbling on the inside, but you wouldn't be able to tell it based on their outside appearance. So I felt them, the ones that I had known. And their eyeliner, as they say, was on fleek at the time. This was about, like I say, about 9 years ago or so. But the point is that I felt like that was something I could control. So I went home, literally. I had never been a makeup-y person. Now keep in mind, I was 32 at the time. I've never been a makeup-y person. I'd always done all the safe stuff. And like I said, coming to grips with losing my hair, I need something that I can control. I can control makeup. Great. All of a sudden, people started to see my makeup transformation. Then a few years later, all of my hair, I went into Universalis, actually. I went from Totalis to Universalis. And I don't know what happened. My body was just like, guess what, Kim? You got to learn how to take the makeup that you've done before that was so easy for you. So it was so easy for me to draw brows. It was so easy for me to put on lashes when I had Totalis. Now you have Universalis. What are you going to do? You have no guide. You have no barrier, you have nothing. No need for exfoliation and what they call it, the planing thing for your skin. You don't need to do that anymore. But I had to figure out a new way. And so what I wanna say to the ladies and gentlemen who are going through transition is that it's okay to find a new way to do something. Because it turns out that I ended up being a testimony for other people who were either going through Totalis, going through Ariata, or going through Universalis. And actually, I have reversed back to Ariata. Didn't know that that existed. I didn't know that the body could do that. But it's decided, hey, your hair is going to grow back, but it's going to grow back looking like this in spots. So the things that I do now for my makeup routine is similar to what I do or what I did when I had Universalis. So what I want to show you guys today, just to give you a little, that was a little backstory. So now we're going to do the application part of it, is what I did when I lost my lashes. When I lost my lashes, keep in mind, I'm sure, well, not all of us are on the same journey, but if you do have Universalis, keep in mind, you don't have that barrier like everybody else is talking about. They always talk about the magnetic lashes or the magnetic lashes that clasp together, the two that clasp together that have the magnets. That is something I would not recommend for someone who does not have lashes. I tried that and I think I had maybe like 4 lashes left. And next thing you know, they were like, bloop. I was like, that was cute. That was a purchase. Put it under the bathroom sink, right? So it was just a part of it. So it was like, okay, you're gonna have to go back to glue. You're gonna have to go back to adhesive. That's what your life is now. My first time doing my lashes without having a barrier, I literally put glue on my contact lens. It was the first time that I was getting used to doing this. And so I had to practice. A lot of people would be like, I'm not doing that ever again. Nope, nope, you can't pay me, nope. And I was like, no, this is a part of my brand. This is who I am. So I have to figure out how to make this work for me. So the one thing that I did is I took my lash, made sure that I had my lash and made sure that it was measured, okay? But the biggest thing that you can do is to get an adhesive or a glue that has a brush tip. So don't get the one that squirts out, the little tube that you squeeze tube, like toothpaste, because before you know it, it's going to be messy. But what I did was put it on my lash line and then put it on the lash. So I'm gonna show you guys what I did, and I hope everyone can see me. Let me get a little closer, sorry. All right, so I made sure that I had this brush tip because that goes across the lash line, similar to how they do magnetic liner now. But keep in mind, for me being a makeup artist, sometimes that magnetic liner does not work for everybody like that. Some people have that sensitivity in the eyes, and this actually is paraben-free and alcohol-free. So you don't know what's going on in those magnetic liners. So you have to be very careful of the ingredients because you don't know how it's going to affect your eyes. So what I did was take the lash and the glue and just dash it across. And I know everybody can see me on this one. So just dash it across. And you're supposed to let it get tacky. That's what they say, let it get tacky. And that means just get a little bit sticky, okay? It can stay on your eye, especially for the Universalis people. For the simple fact that we don't have anything that's happening there. So what I would do after that is take my lash and I would do the same thing and add glue across my lash. The fake lash, sorry. And just dash it across and making sure that the ends, because the ends are always the ones that pop up the most. The ends are always the ones that pop up the most. So it's very important to get those. Another thing, keep in mind that lashes have been in a container. It was a 10 pack, but lashes have been in a container. They are not fit for your eyes. So let's just keep that 100%. They're not fit for your eyes. So you have to get them to be fit. So what you wanna do while you're waiting for this to get tacky on the fake lash, you actually wanna give it a little twist, a little U-turn. The reason why you want a U-turn is because you wanna create the flexibility in the band. That band has been like this, like a little C. The whole time. It's not used to coming out and playing, let's put it that way. So just kind of giving it a little flexibility. And what I would use at the time, and I can't find it now, I would use my tweezers. Some people tweeze, some people don't. But to make sure those ends are down, I'm doing it. So I hope everyone can see me. So you wanna make sure, once again, you have lash glue on the lash and you have lash glue on your lash line. So automatically it should create that same suction together. And you leave it. And these are very natural lashes, and that was one thing I had to learn too. From not having a barrier, the heavier the lash, the more downward it goes. So in order to keep it upward, I had to make sure that I had a double glue barrier. So I don't know how magnetic lashes will work these days, but I know that this is what works for me. So what I do after I drop it off in the middle, you stick and not that, sorry. It was much easier when I didn't have lashes. So that tells you right there. But the bottom line is, pinch. For me, I have to pinch. If you do still have your lashes, guys, then you do have to pinch it down. If you don't have your lashes, then you can leave it, but you need to prop it up until it dries. That was another thing, is propping those lashes up so that way they don't have the tendency to fall. So when it comes to lashes, making sure that the size is right, making sure that you have a double glue barrier using more of a brush tip, and making sure that you do that double on your lash line and having lashes that work for you. So I hope that, that's that. Brows. Let me see, brows. I'm trying to think. What can I say about brows? Brows took practice. I'll be very honest. Brows took a lot of practice. Brows are the frame of the face. So you have to find out what works for you. When I was starting with having Universalis, I realized that the product I was using was a pencil. And the pencil actually was more of a wax-based pencil. So I wasn't using anything to mattify or dry out my skin, because it turns out I have very oily, wide pores and very oily skin up here in this area. I had no idea what kind of oil production was going on in my eyebrows, but turns out it was there. So I actually started doing my foundation first. So that may be a little trick there. Is doing your foundation first and then drawing your brows on. So that way it might stay longer than looking like, as I call it, a neon sign, because that's what they look like. After you sweat it for a while, they start to like, hi, we're here, we're her brows. That's what it looks like. So after a while, you start to do your foundation first. And then you try to figure out, well, what product stays on for a long time. Now, living in this country, it gets up to 130 degrees here. Yeah, and I am very blessed to have found the surefire way of keeping your bald head and your makeup on in 130 degree weather. So I don't melt like most normal people, because I'm a unicorn. So with that being said, you need to make sure that you have your brow pomade. Might be good for you. This is an actual cream that you use with an angle brush. These are known for being products that don't move. They're like move proof. If your base is right. So like I said, make sure that you do your foundation and your powders first. See how that works, and then go into your brows next. What you might also want to use, if you don't feel comfortable with a brush and pomade, is a pencil. But you have to make sure that the pencil is not greasy and creamy. It has to be something that's mattifying. It has to be something that will actually adhere to the skin. So what I do have, I know the Anastasia or Anastasia, depending on where you are in the world, however you pronounce it. Those are really good brow products, as well as Rimmel and Tarte, T-A-R-T-E. So those are really good products as well. And it's all about trial and error. And it doesn't have to be the most expensive. It just has to be the most efficient for you, period, no matter what anyone says. So that is my presentation on brows and lashes. I hope you enjoyed.
Oh my goodness. Thank you so much. That was incredible. Well. Thank you. I was taking notes, literally.
Take away.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you. All right. So, and just a reminder for everyone, we're going to be collecting all the Instagrams and websites and pages for our guest speakers today, and we will be putting them on the PowerPoint slide that you'll see at the end of our webinar episode today. And also, please, you can go ahead and start typing in your questions in the chat. And we will be asking those at the end of our, after everyone gives their presentation today. All right, so we are moving on to talk about wigs. So I have the pleasure of introducing Miss Toni Malone. She was first diagnosed with alopecia areata at 10 years old. And she has been working in the wig industry since 2013. So has a lot of knowledge out there about wig care and wigs. Toni has embraced being bald. She loves wearing wigs and has become a wig expert along the way. We are so excited to welcome Miss Toni Malone to our webinar episode today. Toni, please take it away.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity of being here. So I just want to say first and foremost, you know, I'm bald and I love being bald, but I find that wigs for me are really fun. And I don't wear the same wig every day. Now I switch it up. I wear long one day, short the next. So for me, it's not a hiding factor. It's just more of a fun thing. It's kind of an accessory. I find like it goes with my outfits. And then I just go into whatever mood that I feel like at that time, or even if I don't want to wear a wig, it's become like more of a fun thing for me. And you know, when I was first diagnosed and I was a child, it was very hard having wigs, you know, young, and they weren't like they are now. So it was very hard for me to figure out. And it was like, you know, synthetics, and there just wasn't options like there is now. So fast forward to what we have available today, it's really great. You can do so many things. I personally wear human hair wigs. So I'll be talking about human hair wigs and what kind of hair and what kind of wigs that I like. And I just became an expert on the way. I kind of self-taught myself. So I'll go ahead and start. Now, first, I'll show you some wigs here. Let me see if I have to stand up. So first, I go by the texture of how the hair feels. Now, I like virgin hair wigs. There's different types of hair. Virgin just means that you could dye it, you can color it, you could do all different like highlights to it. Now, if you get certain hair that you can't color, you have to just make sure you can get like a strand test. There's like processed types of hair. The processed, you can usually darken. Some of the hair is hard to lighten, but sometimes it could be, you just don't know how the hair has been processed. So usually if you take it to a stylist, they can strand test it and see if the hair will take that. But virgin hair, you can do anything to it color-wise. So I like the virgin because then I could do highlights. And I just like the softness, the texture, and the way the hair feels. Now, the way I go when I buy a wig, I go on movement. Now, if you could see here on this wig, I test how the hair moves and the flow of it, because it's very important. You can just tell right away the way the hair looks, like the texture wise. And that's kind of the guide that I go on. Now, very important when you buy a wig, the little things to check. Now here on the back of the wig, like the bottom here, where it rubs on the back of your neck, you always want to check here, because if it has knotting, this has become a big problem. People, when they make the wigs, they're sewing it in a certain way. And if they're not putting it in a correct way going downward, what happens is it knots really bad. And then you have this rat nest going on. So I always check the way this is made to make sure that I don't have that, because I bought many wigs in the past where it's gotten really bad and the hair fell out and it's just like a rat's nest, and trying to comb it, it's been very challenging. So, and now I'm going to talk about how to secure it and how to fit it on your head and what to check when you know, if you have no hair and you want to know ways to keep it on your head and what sizing. Now, sizing is a little more complicated because obviously, you know, everybody has a different size head. You can do custom where they measure you and then, you know, your wig will fit accordingly to your head. Now, sometimes that doesn't always work out, because when you go to a wig shop, they already have wigs made, and sometimes they're not your size. So you either have to get it fixed to your sizing, or you have to have little tricks to put in. So I'm a small on my wigs. I do silicone inside, where it just adheres to my baldness on my head and it sticks. I don't wear tape or anything like that, or glue. Everybody has their own preference. There's also things out there that you can use to secure it. They have these little snazzy wig grips. You can buy them anywhere, I think on Amazon, wig shops. And then you could just put it on your head, and the Velcro and the material from your head and the wig keeps it secure. If you don't want to spend money on getting the wig size, because that could be costly, or then you have to they have to cut your wig up. So here's the wig grip. You can just put it on your head and you go around, and then you Velcro it in the back, and then you kind of just move it up to where you feel like, you know, your wig's gonna fit. And then you go ahead and put the wig on. And this is just a way to keep it really secure without having to, you know, change the wig up. Cost, you know, having somebody cut it up and re-sew it and do all that. Now, instantly, this is like really tight on my head. And you go outside, it's windy. You can totally feel the suction of it right on my head. So it's great. It's an option. They're about $20. Amazon, just type in wig grips. They have all different brands. It doesn't matter. They're pretty much all the same. There's a lot of knockoffs. Everybody's making them now. Wig stores are selling their own and just putting their names on it, naming it, you know, whatever they want to name it or brand it. But pretty much that's it. And you can hand wash them in the sink. But that's a great way to secure your wig. And I could even show you just moving. It's not even moving on my head. It's like instantly, it's great. So that's an option. Now I'm going to get into washing. If you wash your own wig, I also have a wig stylist that does a lot of my styling and coloring, and she washes them. But there's sometimes I wash my own wig, and I've kind of learned what to do. So now I'm going to show you. You can get these basins or like things anywhere. Supermarket stores, you know, they're just basically, this one I like, it's like a salad bowl actually, but it's great because it's big and you can put the wig right in here. You just get some lukewarm water, fill it in there, and then I use salon grade shampoo and conditioner. And that's very important because you don't want to use anything that's just, you know, really, you don't have to go crazy on the cost of it, but I would just recommend a salon grade product. Now, I wouldn't get anything from the grocery store that has like a VO5 or anything like that, just because the ingredients in it. So one product that I love that I recommend is Bumble and Bumble. Now, this is a shampoo and a conditioner quenching. I just put some lukewarm water in the basin, put a squirt in there, and then I let it soak, let it sit in there, let it soak for a little while. And then when I'm rinsing it, I'm making sure I'm not, you know, rubbing it like this. I don't want to damage the hair or pull the hair. I'm just kind of letting it rinse down and just letting it flow and just going down with my hands. I'm not doing any scrunching because then that causes knots and you could rip out the hair. Because, you know, the one important thing on the wig is the top part. Now that's just a little tip here. So anything you do with your wig, washing, brushing, anything like that, you just always want to be, you know, careful of the top part, because it's the way they make the top, the scalps, it depends on what kind of scalp you buy. If you have lace front, you know, if they're sewing it all in here, you have to be very careful that you're not ripping the hair out. So that's the one key I always say, is just be careful with the top part. So basically, you can do, once you wash it, I just let it air dry. after I clean it, shampoo and conditioner, I let it air dry. And I let it lay down on the counter on a towel for a little bit. And then later on, when it's almost dry or dry, I put it on one of these, you know, hair statue things. And then you can style it yourself or take it to somebody that, you know, can style it, whatever you prefer. I do have a few tips also when you're brushing the wig. I find this is very important. So you're holding the wig, you got a brush. You're not brushing from the top down. And the reason for that is because you're ripping the knots out at the top and it's going to pull the hair up. So the one trick that I've learned way long ago is when you hold the wig and the brush, you're going to brush from the bottom up. So you're just going to go like this and brush down from the bottom and go up. And you just do that all over the hair, all over the wig. And this just helps it not rip anything out from the top. And I always brush my wigs like that. And I find that that's one of the important keys. The most expensive thing of the wig is the top. You ruin the top or anything happens to it, it's very costly to get it fixed. Sometimes it can't be fixed. It just depends on what the issues are. So I just make sure they're kind of like, you know, my babies in a sense, where I have to take care of them. And I just really careful on what to do. So if you have any questions, you know, later on and you want to ask me little tricks of the trade, but I would recommend just make sure the brushing, just be very gentle with it, you know, don't pull on the hair too much. When you're styling, just make sure that if you're blow drying or anything, you're just very soft with it. You know, and they last a long time if you just take care of them. They're, you know, I've had, and especially that I switch off a lot, they last me long. So I feel like if you just take the time and just, you know, keep up on the upkeep of them and very gentle, you'll have no problems with the tops or the, any of the hair. It's usually a good thing to do there. Also now, the next thing I want to talk about is, now price ranges. Okay. So price ranges, I just, when I go shopping and look at wigs, and I know it's very hard online. I know a lot of people get nervous and say, you know, I don't know how to buy a wig online. So when I buy wigs online, it's a process. You just have to make sure, you know, because you don't see what you're getting. It's very hard. They can tell you. I recommend finding a place that has exchanges. If you buy online nowadays, the good thing is they have to return it if you don't like it, as long as it's not custom. So I recommend that option, because then if you don't like it or it's not fitting, you can, you know, send it back. Price range, I would say for human hair, if you're looking for something, you don't have to, I know a lot of people say $5,000 for a wig. I don't ever really spend $5,000 for a wig. I think that's a little outrageous. I feel like I could go get a used car for $5,000, you know? So I just recommend, just make sure the quality of hair is good. It's a good processed hair or virgin hair. And just see how the feel of the hair, it's really the feel of the hair and the, what type of texture. There's so many different textures. I kind of just know what I like, but, it's just a process. You kind of learn as you go. And as long as it's movement, it has a good feel to it, and you feel like you can comb it. Another test is the comb, putting your hairbrush in it. If it gets knotty, you don't want that wig. If it gets stuck in there, no. So you just, if it's just combing through like gliding, you know you're going to have great hair. So there's a lot of different tips, but anybody can reach out and ask me if they want to know further and all those different things, and I'm happy to help you. And thank you very much for the time and the opportunity.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Toni. We really, really appreciate it. I was sitting down here jotting down notes because I still wear wigs myself, and some of the stuff I did not know at all. So thank you so much. If you guys have any other questions for Toni, again, we'll be doing the Q&A towards the end. So put them in the chat and then we'll be ready to chat with her afterwards. So moving along, we will have Miss Yaz Gomez Lopez. She is a fabulous 30-year-old. She currently lives in London, England. She has been shaving her head and using headscarves since she was diagnosed with alopecia areata at the age of 8 years old. So over the years, Yaz has been working on accepting and loving herself again, and we'll share her Instagram and everything kind of at the end. I suggest that you follow her. You'll get so many tips on just lifestyle, just the acceptance on just learning to be you and loving who you are with alopecia. So without further ado.
Okay.
All right, you guys, we are not sure what happened. We apologize for this. I don't know, technicality. Anyhow, we are restarting. I was just introducing Yasmin. So she is going to go ahead and get started and talking with us about wig care and sales.
Hello. So first of all, I'm from Spain, so I want to apologize for my English because it's not perfect, but I'm going to try. But of course, if I make mistakes, which I probably will, you all excuse me, because I've been living out of Spain for 8 years, so my English should be better than it is for now. But yeah, I'm going to try to do my best. So I was diagnosed, like Renee says, I was diagnosed with alopecia when I was 18. So, of course, it's a really tricky age because that's when I was building my personality, my femininity and everything. When I started losing my hair, I really feel like all that was taken away. And, of course, I didn't know anybody else with alopecia because I'm from Granada, south of Spain. So it's a small city. I didn't know anybody else who had it and all that. So I started wearing wigs when I first got diagnosed, kind of like to hide, like someone mentioned, but they were really uncomfortable for me. They were not good, like quality, the ones I got, obviously, and they were not for me. They were causing a lot of stress. So I started watching YouTube videos on how to do head scarves. That was kind of my thing from there to now, actually. I started to use them to hide it first and to cover my head because I didn't want to show that I was bald. Now I use it as another compliment, like I use my earrings. And all these years, which has been 13 years now, I'm 31 now. So I've been working on feeling as comfortable with my bald head as I feel with covering it. So like a breaking point for me, it was when I moved to England, like I said, 8 years ago, and then I moved to the US 5 years ago, I think now, or six. And that's when I started getting a lot of compliments on my style. And I was like, I don't even have a style. What style is people talking about? I just wear whatever I feel like wearing, whatever I feel that suits me. And everybody was like, oh, I love your style. Nobody even assumed I had alopecia or anything going on. They just thought my scarves were like part of my style and how I wanted to dress. And I thought that was really fun. And I started like using it more in that way. I started trying to match them with my outfit more and things like that. That's when I was gaining my femininity back, because I really felt like, I always felt like hair was the thing that was making me a sexy woman or pretty woman. And that's from there, that's when I started working on accepting the way I look. Like even my clothes reflect that change. Like before, I used to wear like really loose clothes or like a lot of black, like always black too, because I was just trying to not be seen by anybody. And through the years, you can see like now I want to be seen because I'm happy with who I am and the way I look, and my clothes reflect that. But I was working a lot on finding all the things that got me my femininity back or the way I felt. With no having hair, which is like, I use a lot of big earrings, like you can see. I wear lipstick most of the time because I like it. I don't wear makeup a lot because I have eczema and my face gets really bad, but I do sometimes. And I wear sunglasses if it's sunny, or like normal glasses because I need them, but I try to make them stylish. and I'm like working like tattoos and things like that that like complements my outfit and like makeup for the lack of hair. In my opinion, back then, that's what I was trying to do, like find all the things to replace the hair. So I want to talk a bit about hair scarves. I'm going to show two videos that I already recorded. I'm going to try to share my screen in a bit, and I'm going to pause them to explain what I'm doing. But I wanted to talk about different like materials, because I'm really fussy with them. I'm not sure how everybody is, but it has to feel right in my head, otherwise I can't wear them. So this is like, I'm not sure obviously if you can appreciate on the screen, but I'm going to try to explain. This is more like silk. It's more like a shiny thing, and I find it really, I don't wear them a lot, even though they are more elegant, or I use them for like nicer events or nicer outings. I find they are like easier to move on my head. I don't feel them so secure, because they're more like slippery touch. Like I don't feel really safe with them, to say so. And then there is this material which is more like cotton. It's not cotton, but it's more like this fabric, like any t-shirt you can have. And also everybody asks me where I buy them, and I buy them anywhere. Like I have some that are from like clothes shops like H&M or like Zara or anything. Like they are actually head, like neck scarves, the one I use in my head. Like it doesn't have to be any particular shape. But these, the ones I use, they're like rectangular. They're really neck scarves, but also I buy them in street markets or whatever, really cheap. Like in Spain, you can buy them for €2. It's really not about like that. It's about how they feel on the head. And then I have more, like I have different ones for different occasions. Like this one has glitter. It will go on your clothes. Like the glitter is going to go everywhere. But yes, I have like loads of them, and basically depending on what I'm wearing, I do them in a style or another style. So I'm going to show you two of them because I don't want to make these too long. But if you have any questions, I'm going to try to share my screen now. Hopefully you can see what I'm trying to show. I'm not sure what I'm doing here. Oh, here. I hope you can see now. So this is the first video I want to show, and what I'm doing here, oh, let me stop this. So what I do I use a smaller scarf under the main scarf, because first of all, my head is really small. And then second of all, in winter, I get cold. So I put two scarves. But that's the only reason. So this is the scarf I would wear underneath. I just tie it like normally, like with my head down, and leave it like that. And then I get the main scarf, which again is just rectangular, like it's a normal scarf from any shop. And then I put it from the neck up, and I get the two sides. I make sure I get them really tight, because that's what's going to keep it without moving. And then I just roll it, like on the video. And then again, I make like a band around my hair, like a bum on top. Like, again, I try to do it tight, because I don't tie it or anything. I just leave it like that, and then I move it backwards, depending on how tight you like it or how backwards or whatever. And this is the first style. Let me get this. I hope you hear what I was saying while watching the video, because I'm not really sure. And this is another different style. What I'm doing here is you need one side. Again, it's a normal scarf. It's rectangular. And one side, I leave it shorter than the other. And then just put it like that, and then tie it on the back, as I'm about to show, I believe. Yeah, just a normal knot. And again, you want to make it tight, because that's what's going to keep it in your head without moving. So you feel safe. It's not going to move anywhere. And then I do a double one, because again, my head is really small and I get cold, and some of my scarves are see-through. So I do this. and then you tie again. And like this, what's going to happen is one side is going to be shorter than the other, so it's going to look nicer when you put, I put it on my side, so it looks shorter like that, and that's never going to move. Like, I find it really good. I work as a nanny, so I find it really good. How do I start sharing my screen now? That's the question. How do I do that? Oh, sugar. I don't know, girls, how to start. Oh, how do I start sharing my screen so you can see me? Oh, sugar, wow, I don't
know. You should be able to click up at the top. It should be like a red button and it should say stop sharing.
I got it now. Sorry about this.
It's awesome. We got probably about 7 more minutes, you asked me?
Okay, good. So that's about scarves. I do different styles. I try to like match them with my clothes. Again, I use like sunglasses, loads of things like to make me feel feminine and good. And I'm a nanny, so my job allows me to be really casual on my style. So I wear loads of jeans and leggings because I'd be playing at the playground or lying on the floor, whatever. So my style is normally really casual, and I basically wear, like I said, I basically wear what I feel comfortable with. That's the most important thing for me. Obviously, it has to be appropriate. Like, I'm not going to be wearing leggings to a wedding. But like in my day to day, I really just wear what I feel that suits me and what I'm comfortable wearing. And it's really casual, and but also sometimes I have to like dress up nicer. And I know not everybody is as lucky as me to have that amazing job, and some people work in offices or things like that. So like for a more like an office attire or more like dress up style, I wanted to show like two different styles with like Bane Ball. Like, this is like, again, main thing for me is the compliments, like the earrings and the belt and the handbag, and always like lipstick and things like that to make the look for me look really elegant. To be honest, when I really dress up for things, I find Bane Bold is more elegant than wearing a scarf. So I really feel like to a nice thing, I would rather go bold. And also, like, I feel really empowered on my clothes when I dress up like that. I'm wearing heels. That makes a difference. So this is something I would wear to a more, like, dress-up thing. And, like, an office job or whatever. Like, I always wear earrings. But, like, those are the things that, high heels and stuff like that. But I find these things are, to me, I could go ball rather than with my head scarf, which is what I use for more like day to day. But yes, like, again, like, just wrap it up. Like, main thing about style to me is to wear what you feel comfortable wearing and whatever you feel that suits you, and just rock it. But I wanted to say thank you for giving me the chance to talk today. It was a pleasure, and I'm just listening to everybody here, taking notes myself too, and I'm learning a lot. But thank you, guys.
Thank you so much, Yasmin. Thank you for sharing your expertise with us. All right, guys, I appreciate the ones who are able to log back on, and if you were not, just remember that we will have this recorded and it will be posted to the NAF website. So last but not least, we have Miss Ebony Jean. Ebony was diagnosed with alopecia universalis at the age of 8 years old. In 2016, she revealed herself to the world via social media. beginning her journey of self-love and acceptance. Ebony is now an advocate for the alopecia community. She loves to help other patients, basically love the skin they're in. She loves to spread awareness. She is a woman of God, a makeup artist, and also a lover of all things fashion and beauty, and she hopes that her journey will inspire others. I remember meeting Ebony at a NAF conference. I don't even remember what year. And then I just was so inspired by her. And I started following her on social media. I love how she shares her faith, her acceptance, her beauty, her wigs, just being herself, which is why we invited her today and kind of ended with Ebony. Everything that everyone shared, she's kind of everybody all bottled in one. So without further ado, Ebony, you can take it away.
Thank you so much, Renee. Oh my goodness. I believe we met back in 2017. It was either the 2017 or 2018 conference.
Mm-hmm.
But I remember, the day we met, it was like one of the last days, and it was just such an amazing experience. But thank you so much for having me on here. I'm very grateful. So I was diagnosed with alopecia actually at the age of 4. So I thought it was areata at first, but then when my mom took me to the doctor, they confirmed it as universalis. So when I grew up, I was dealing with hair loss, of course, and the battle of having to cover my head. So I went through all the changes of wearing hats to school and dealing with educators who didn't understand my issue. And I'm not sure if we have any parents who are watching, but I know that if you have a child with alopecia or if you have grown up with alopecia, then you understand the frustration of your child having to live a life of normalcy, you know, without everyone trying to be, I would say not understanding the issue, if that makes sense. But my mom fought for me very hard to get my education like everyone else. And I went through a lot of stress during that time, next to dealing with other illnesses for alopecia. My wig journey began in the 5th grade. So I was just 9 years old. And that was the last official time I had my hair. So my mom made my first headband wig. And it was difficult adjusting to it because I didn't know what it was. No one where I grew up knew about alopecia. So we had very seldom help in the community. And when my mom made my wig and also the hats that she created, everyone found it stylistically, but it was actually therapeutic for her to do. Although she couldn't make the pain and go away and wipe the tears away, she did what she knew how to as a parent. So I'm very grateful for her in that aspect. And growing up in the church, you know, I've always been taught to put my trust in God and to be of good cheer, you know, to be encouraged, because I know that going through something like this can be very traumatic. Hair loss is a very traumatic thing to experience, no matter what age you are. So growing up, it was very stressful. I've had to fight off different cancer rumors, as all of us have been through that at some point, and try to live a life of normalcy, making friends, everything else under the spectrum. I would say things didn't really quiet down until after high school. So all of the bullying and teasing stopped in middle school, but that's when the cancer rumors picked up. So of course, my mom had to call all the educators and explain what was going on, how alopecia affects her as a parent, and what the schools can do to accommodate me as a student so I could get my education like everyone else. Transitioning to college was quite frustrating because you're getting into that generation of wanting to date and go out, be more social, have fun, of course, with high school as well. But with college, it's just more profound because you don't look like everyone else and you're trying to find your way through life. So I was rejected constantly. I've dealt with a lot of mistreatment, people saying that you'll never get a boyfriend, you'll never do this, you'll never do this, you'll never be successful. And I had to learn at a very early age that hair does not define who you are. So dealing with that lesson, you know, through elementary school, I didn't know what beauty was. I thought you had to have long hair and be of a certain skin complexion, because I was bullied for other things as well. So being a chocolate girl in school, people teased me for my skin color. They teased me for not having hair at all, for wearing wigs. And it's funny how people within my community teased me for this, because I know growing up in the Black community, we're taught that hair is our crown. It is our glory. That is what makes us who we are. And when I, you know, when I didn't have that peace with all the other girls, you know, I just felt left out. And I felt like a part of me was gone, a part of my femininity was gone, watching my hair fall out and grow back for so many years. And people would really ridicule me about it because of it. So it was really discouraging to find out that people mistreat you based off of your appearance, and they would exclude you purposely because they simply don't understand. So I've had to fight off numerous years of cancer rumors, the ignorance. I've worn wigs for 19 years, and to this day, doctors still look at alopecia as a cosmetic disease, in which it is not. So in 2016, I went public with my story for the very first time, and I'm very grateful for that opportunity, because honestly speaking, I did not plan on going public with this at all. I was going to take this with me to my grave, but I'm so grateful that I'm finally in a place where I can talk about it. And I've noticed that there's healing, you know, when you talk about it. So being able to find such an incredible, wonderful community of people with alopecia, I've met everyone from all across the world. And I'm so grateful for these relationships, hearing the different stories of how everyone has overcome their experiences. And when they were diagnosed, you know, I thought I was dealing with this all by myself. Come to find out I wasn't. And my mom and I traveled to the NAF conference for the very first time the year I revealed myself. So in 2016, we went to Washington, D.C., and everyone just embraced me with open arms. I didn't know what to expect, what was coming, but they said, if you have never gone without your wig before, you will by the end of this conference. And I'm thinking, are you sure about that? I don't think I'm going to, but they definitely proved me wrong. So I'm very grateful for that. Now I've been traveling all over the country, sharing my story, working with legislators in Washington, D.C. to get a bill passed to have wigs covered under Medicaid insurance. So out of the 19 years of wearing wigs, my mom and I have spent hundreds to thousands of dollars just trying to keep my head covered. This is a major necessity within the alopecia community, and I really hope that medical officials will take this condition more seriously, because it does create a financial insecurity, that type of burden on families who are working class or who have difficulty affording these hair pieces for their children or even for themselves. So it is very important that we're trying to get this bill passed, and I really pray that it does come to pass because it is heavily needed. So my mom was a single mom, and she didn't have a lot of financial help growing up dealing with alopecia. And also I am a beauty influencer for our community. So I was given the opportunity to represent a few brands, including Makeup Geek, which is from my hometown in Michigan, and as well as the Lip Bar. So the Lip Bar is an amazing brand, and I've been blessed with the opportunities to represent both companies, also sharing different tips and techniques on how to draw eyebrows. I've been drawing eyebrows since I was 16 years old. My mom and my eldest sister taught me how, and they would draw them for me each morning before school until gaining the independence. So I've become an independent makeup artist, working with different brands, including Sephora. So I'm very thankful for these opportunities. And I just want to be of an encouragement to everyone with alopecia. I know as women, we tend to get discouraged because we see everyone in the beauty industry. You know, we all can't look like some of the mainstream models that we see out here today. And although the general public praises their beauty, that is not the only way of beauty. So beauty comes in all shapes, sizes, colors, different styles of beauty. And I didn't know that I could be comfortable in my own skin dealing with alopecia. So I'm very grateful that I was able to come forward with my story and remember that it is not the end of the world if you lose your hair. You have so much to offer to this world. You are beautiful just the way you are. You don't have to change who you are in order to get people to like you. I've had tried doing that for so many years, and that obviously didn't work because we are all uniquely and wonderfully made in the eyes of God. So I'm very grateful for everyone embracing me and for being in this incredible group of women. Remember that hair does not define who you are, and you have so much to offer.
Awesome. Thank you, Ebony, so much for just sharing your story with us. It's very powerful. I've loved seeing your transformation and just learning just a little bit more about you. We are going to go to the Q&A session that we did have. And you guys, we had to make a couple of changes to it, but that's neither here nor there. Dr. Gunther, if we can go ahead and start with you. I know that you are in clinic right now. And then we'll kind of get to everyone else. But before you start, if you could unmute yourself, we're just asking a personal question.
Sure.
Just speaking to the alopecia community and just hearing from all these beautiful people. I guess we'd like to ask kind of how me and Angela start off. Like, what is your true definition of beauty? Right? Well, think really about it.
And actually I've gotten this from that same question from patients before, which is always very interesting. So if it feels a little rehearsed, you know, it's a little bit in clinic mode. You know, it's really being comfortable with yourself. I mean, a lot of people will come to plastic surgeons and be like, what do I need to be beautiful? What do I need to be? And I tell people, it really is the inside of you and how you want to portray yourself and how you see your, how your life and your kind of outside expression to the world. And there's a lot of different ways to be able to kind of do that. But I think that it is personal for each and every person. And I think, you know, finding acceptance in yourself and finding what is kind of your role in kind of the world, I think is a lot of times the most having that confidence and is the most way, you know, is the best way to kind of be beautiful kind of to the world and kind of the ideal beauty. And I think that's different for every person. And there's a lot of adjuncts to do that to you, I talked about a lot of women have talked about, you know, fashion and their style and their accessories and stuff like that. And that's your personal brand that you kind of bring to the world and you really bring out and bloom into your own personal beauty. And I think that's probably for me is the biggest definition of it.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. So I guess starting with, we had a couple of questions. One of them was, would you use isotretinoin, if I'm saying that correctly, on anybody with eczema?
So personally, I actually have eczema. So one, you can. Oftentimes people with eczema, as anyone with eczema will know, it makes your skin much, much more sensitive. So those will definitely be the people that will have a little bit of a longer kind of transition period when starting tretinoin or any topical vitamin A sort of derivatives. But more importantly, those will be the type of people that should really shy away from products that have fragrances in them, because those can also be cause irritation, can actually cause inflammation, which leads to kind of worsening of eczema and kind of the dry skin. Those might also be the people that start on lower doses of tretinoin. And maybe instead of doing every day, we'll do every other day to kind of cut down on the dryness and reactions that they might have, but definitely possible.
Okay. A lot of us, of course, we have the bald head. Some of us go out with it every day. Is there anything that you would do in terms of the difference in skincare from our face versus like on our scalp or anything like that?
Excellent question. Skin is sort of skin, but skin on the scalp can be a little bit more oily. Obviously, that is due to typically the oil glands on the scalp are made to kind of cause the oils for the hair to kind of coat them. So some people will have more oiliness of skin on their heads. as well. Now, remember, I did talk a lot about sunscreen. Now, remember, the top of your head is shining towards the sun, and the sun is coming down on that. So even more importantly, if you do have a bald head, would be sunscreen on the top of your head. You do not want to get burned. You know, like I talked about, UV radiation causes cancer in everybody. And if it is something that is going to be more exposed to the sun, those are going to be definitely sunscreen, sunscreen, sunscreen. With that said, a lot of times you can wash the skin the same that you would wash, such as your face. Some people will have, like I said, a little bit more oiliness on their scalp. So maybe a lighter moisturizer on the top of the head and a more of a thicker moisturizer on the face may be an option. But like I said, that's something to kind of play with, kind of with time.
Okay. And we had another question about what are your thoughts about extractions?
So extractions kind of in the long run can cause more damage. So it's kind of one of those, if you have traumatic extractions that can lead to inflammation, can lead to scar tissue. Gentle extractions can be okay. I would say you would want those to be done by usually a dermatologist or someone that is well-trained in those. I had patients that have had extractions that leads to scarring from those extractions, which is kind of a permanent thing. I usually like to think of, you know, keeping a good skin care regimen that keeps your pores clean is probably a better option than kind of going through the, you know, extractions. And I understand that, but I think those that would be wanting to get extractions, I would stick to someone that is, you know, very trained in them and probably with, like I said, like a dermatologist or someone on those.
Okay. And then Ebony asks, are there any tips on scarring on the scalp? Any tips for scarring on the scalp?
So scarring obviously is a very difficult thing. Some people can have hypertrophic or keloid type scarring that can form. Believe it or not, a scar, once you get a cut and it heals, it actually takes almost an entire year for the remodeling and the changes of the collagen for it to kind of form into its full scar. So even though the skin is sort of closed, it's the clock is about a year to fully heal. Sunscreen is most important for those scars. As those scars are healing, they are less protected from the sun, and you can get more inflammation and get worse scars when you have sun kind of touches. So usually I tell anyone that has a surgical procedure that about a year's of time you have to have sunscreen on your scars because that's the best way to get a good scar healing. The topical thing, topical scar creams, vitamin E oil, I actually don't really work. And actually on my website, I have a whole kind of blog post about scars. The only thing that has really shown anything other than sun care, slight scar massage after about 2 weeks, and then silicone sheeting, which may not be an option for it on your head, are the two things that are kind of most helpful in scars. If you are someone that forms keloid or hypertrophic type scarring, you can do injections of steroids that can help with that if you are that type of person that gets those types of scars. But those are kind of the options.
Great. Thank you so much for sharing that. I do at some point between now and noon want to take a photo of all of us smiling. So that will be coming. I won't just snap it without you knowing. I'm going to let you know. We're going to count to three. We're going to take the photo. We'll wait for Renee to get back. I had a question for Miss Kimberly, actually. We were talking about sun and protection of the head, and I feel like it might be possible that you are one of the few, if not only, that has experienced like the highest volume of sunlight on the scalp. And so just wanted to hear any additional information that you might be able to give about protection from the sun on your head.
Okay, ever since I moved here, I've used SPF 30 all the way up to SPF 50. So I don't play with this here. I knew that would make you happy. Yeah, I don't play with this sun here because you step outside and all of a sudden you feel like you thought you moisturized and everything just went from your skin, and it's crazy here. But you have to protect yourself. And like you were saying, Dr. Sven, in your presentation, you know, just because you have melanin doesn't mean that you can't wrinkle, and you still have to protect yourself. It doesn't matter. You're protecting yourself by moisturizing. You're protecting yourself with the SPF. And some products, like what Dr. Sven was saying in his presentation, do have SPF in them. So it works out very well. However, it's a lower grade of SPF. So some foundations will come with SPF 15 or 20, but here, yeah, you need all the ammo of 30 to 50 here. Yeah, and it needs to be consistent. That's another thing, consistency, not just one time and go. No, it has to be consistent, definitely being here.
Great, great. I'm gonna, Renee, if it's okay with you, I wanted to snap our photo now while everybody's here and just ready for a photo. Is that okay? Everyone has their smile ready. And I'm going to post this. Just if anyone has any objections, let me know. Okay, no objections. Great. All right, everybody. Ooh, I see Dr. Sven kind of get ready. Okay. Ready? Okay, here we go. And we're gonna okay, we're gonna do two more. Okay, can we do a funny one? Is that okay? Yeah, okay. Okay. Awesome. Okay, we're continuing on with the questions. So I have a question for Miss Tony. So we had someone in the chat ask about vacuum wigs. I'm actually not familiar with these, but they wanted to know, do you have any tips on how to get them on? Are they safe? So can you speak briefly about vacuum wigs?
Sure. Vacuum wigs are like a suction. It's more like a helmet kind of deal. There's a lot of those out there. They're made to be like if you're into sports, swimming. I know they're that's what their goal is for those vacuum wigs. That's what they're designed for. What was the question? How to keep it on? I'm sorry.
Yeah, how to apply them? It sounds like any tips on how to put them on, and then is it safe to use?
The way they're kind of interesting in my opinion. The way they're made, they suction on. So they're kind of difficult. The ones I've tried to, you know, tried on, you have to really get them on your head and then they kind of suction down. So it's kind of a difficult situation to say how to get it on the head. It's the way they're made and they kind of have air in there. And then when they get on the head, they kind of reminds me of a hydraulic, if you will. You know, they kind of like, once you get it on, the air and everything in there.
Yeah.
I don't personally wear vacuum wigs. Not really my choice of style. I always say, in my opinion with wigs, there's a wig for everybody. Everybody has different, what they like. And so if you like vacuums, they're, you know, they could work for you. For me, they're heavy and they're very hot. But if they work for you, they could be a good choice. That's pretty much my take on vacuum wigs.
Great. Thank you for sharing. Now I'm thinking about it. I would have really benefited from a vacuum wig, I think, playing sports in school. I have a question. I'm going to turn it into like a kind of multifaceted question. I want to get more than one person's perspective on this. So it's about sunspots. So someone had a question about how to remove or lighten sunspots. And so I definitely want Dr. Sven to speak to his expertise, but I also know there are a lot of individuals here who have tips on skin in general and makeup tips as well. And so I just wanted to kind of get everyone's perspective, if you feel comfortable sharing, and we can start off with Dr. Sven.
So sunspots are obviously caused by changes in the skin cells that lead to dyspigmentation, which means, you know, more pigmented area or uneven sort of pigmentation, and that can be sort of a permanent change. Tretinoin actually does help with that, in kind of evening out the skin tones. Kind of treatments for it depend on where your skin tone is and kind of what your skin tone. So there's something called intense pulse light, which is IPL, which can help kind of get out some of those areas as well. There are some lasers that can also be used for those areas as well. Some people like to use lightening creams. I don't like those as much because you can't use them all the time. I feel like if there isn't really a permanent option, that's not a great option for everybody, can be used for them. But like I said, mostly the tretinoin, IPL, the intense pulse light and laser. And number four is I've beat enough sunscreen. So if you don't have the reaction of the melanocytes to the sun, you get less pigmentation, which actually can improve sunspots.
Okay, who wants to answer next?
Turmeric. Yeah, so for particular spots, whenever you have darkness in specific areas, for instance, if we have like the maskne thing going on nowadays, or dark hyperpigmented areas, turmeric, lemon, and honey actually work very well as masks. And you can use those in the particular areas to lighten them up, but do not just leave or just rinse the turmeric off or the mask off, because it will leave a yellow spot. And I know you don't want that either. So you need to make sure that you exfoliate that area as well to make sure that all of the remnants of the mask is gone. So turmeric actually helps as well.
Great, great. Any more tips out there on sunspots? No? Okay, we're moving on. There was a question that we just got. Actually, I'm gonna go back to Miss Tony about the most, actually, I'm gonna ask Miss Tony, I'm gonna have you answer second. I'm gonna have Miss Ebony answer this first, and then I'll get Tony to kind of add in her expertise as well. So Miss Ebony, this is a wig question. So I had a question from one of our participants. What is the most secure wig that can be used?
The most secure wig that can be used is a full lace, front wig. So I received a question earlier. Someone was asking, what is lace front? So it's basically an invisible hairline that appears natural, and it gives you more security because you have the adjustable straps in the back of the wig. So regardless of your head size, you can adjust it to your level of comfortability. And then when it comes to securing the wig, there are different adhesive options available. So you can try double-sided tape or what they call dress-up tape that you will put underneath your dresses whenever you're showing cleavage. You can wear those types of tape underneath your wigs to secure it. Also, there is a got to be hair glue, but I'm not sure how safe and legitimate that is. I've seen a lot of people on social media use it, but I personally don't use it because I've had some ill experiences in the past of, you know, getting a stronger adhesive similar to that, and it ripped the scalp skin off of like the upper part of my head. So I would definitely try double-sided tape and also checking out the full lace front wigs for your options.
Awesome. Miss Tony, what can you add to that information for the group?
Well, if you're completely bald, like I said earlier, the silicone is a great option. I've always had great success with the silicone. And there's so many options inside the wig in the material. They could lay the silicone all across, and then the air tabs have the silicone, and you can get it on the nape, where I don't need tape with that. It just sticks to my head normally, but you could put tape on those areas. So that always helps. And then there's those little clips on the back of the nape that you can clip in to make it tighter to really secure the back, which I've always liked those because I feel like it gives me that, you know, that nice tug on the back where it's tighter. So those clips have always been very important to me, and you can adjust them and move them inside. Or if you have a bigger size head, you can move them out. You know, they're very adjustable. Those always worked well for me. And I think the silicone, or like I said, the wig grip, those help. Those are good options for anything that help it keep on the head and tight.
Wonderful, thank you for sharing. I have a question for anyone in the group who still does shaving of their head. So there was an individual who said that they're still shaving their head routinely and just wanted to get some general tips on shaving.
I shave my head still, like I do it, I find it easy because I like to have it like a skin length, so the patches are not so noticeable, because obviously the longer the hair, you can see more the difference with the scalp, especially me. I'm really pale and my scalp is really pale, and my hair is kind of dark. So you can really see the difference where the hair grows. So I try to shave it like as slow as I can. So I find it easy. I find it easier to keep up with it if I do it daily. Like, first of all, it takes shorter time than if I leave it too long and then I have to do it. So I just basically do it every day when I take a shower. I do it in the shower and it's easier for me. But I use shaving cream or soap or anything, because I don't like to do it on my like a dry scalp. But yes, that could be my tip. Like if you like it low, the lowest you can, I find it easier if you do it more often. So I basically do it every day when I take a shower. I just take like 5 minutes to do it, rather than grow the hair and do it, because I like to have it really low all the time. So I just do it very often. Mm-hmm. And I put cream after shaving, so I don't get the like razor bumps. And I got a cream, I can't remember the name now, but I got it off Amazon. It's called No Head Bumps or something like that. Like if you type like head, like razor bumps or something, it will show up. And I just put it after shaving, and that helps to keep it smooth.
Same with Yasmi. I shave my head every so often. My hair tends to grow back really fast. So the last time I shaved it was just a few weeks ago, and I'm scheduled to get a shave today. But after I shave down my patches, I like to apply tea tree oil because it helps with scalp inflammation. And I have eczema as well. So sometimes I do get a lot of itchiness around like my crown area. So I do use a straight razor. I saw someone just ask that question. Yes, I do use a straight razor. And I like to go straight down. Sometimes I shave upward just to kind of get the trouble hairs, that kind of gets stuck, with trying to shave down completely. But I like to keep it down as much as possible. And I highly recommend using any type of head oil or, something, that has like a liquid base, just so that your scalp stays moisturized.
Great. Someone, to follow up on that, someone was asking how to shave the back of their head.
So when you take your razor, you would go upwards, but I would do it very gently to avoid cutting yourself. So you would shave upward, just like how you would shave going straight back. Do it the opposite way and just take your time doing it. Use any shaving cream of your preference and then just kind of go upwards.
Great, thank you.
I started laughing because I've done that a couple of times. Like, that's a great question. And my fiance, he'll be like, you missed a spot. And I'll be like, Well, that's why I was thinking, I was like, get your fiance to do it. And I'm like, you do it. So just get someone else to do it and make sure that you, you know, check everything. But to piggyback off of what Ebony was saying, you also need to make sure that you understand the grade of how your hair grows. Because not everyone is able to, like for me, I thought, you know, doing the straight back or the straight up was the thing. It turns out that I'm a crisscross, because that's how my hair grows, because my hair grows curly. So it turns out it goes in different directions, like it's dancing. So yeah, you get somebody else to do it. You feel the back of your head, make sure you got all your spots, and make sure that you know how your grade of hair goes.
Perfect. Perfect. Thank you. I have one more question, and then I have a kind of group question that I wanted to ask as well. The group question is going to be, what advice do you have for individuals with alopecia who really feel like they're struggling with their sense of beauty? So keep that in mind. But the last question from the from our live viewers right now are about vitamin E oil. There's someone who is asking about how they use vitamin E oil currently, but they also wanted to try to use sunscreen. And so they're trying to figure out how they can do both. And so can anyone speak to if they use some sort of oil on their scalp as well as sunscreen, and how they go about applying both of those?
What I like to do, I once again apply my oil on my scalp, not just after I shave, but every day to keep it moisturized. Then I will place a wig cap over it just to lock in that moisture, because I know sometimes when you're mixing it with other creams, it tends to lose the texture of it. So I just like to make sure that my scalp locks in that moisture with the cap. And then after removing that for maybe 5 to 7 minutes, it just depends on what you have to do for the day. I will go in with my sunscreen and just put on a light layer, so that way it doesn't overly saturate or kind of like defeat the purpose of what the oil is trying to do. Either way, I do get the moisture that I'm looking for, and just making sure that you're applying it in an even layer.
I was going to say that making sure that you find the right sunscreen is the best thing, because not all sunscreens are created equal. I have found that some of the textures, no, seriously, these textures, I was like, okay, I'm gonna get SPF 50. Yeah, they've got SPF 50. And it was the oiliest thing that I've ever encountered. And I was like, oh my gosh, what is this? So I ended up having to go back to my old faithful that I've been with for 9 years now, Mary Kay. Mary Kay is one of the best sunscreens on the market. I swear by it. And especially if it helps me to survive out here, I definitely think you guys should run out and get it. I don't use vitamin E oil. I'm not familiar with that. Basically, my skin regimen is whatever I use on my face, it's going to trickle all the way around. So like Dr. Sven was saying, skin is skin. And I learned that a long, long time ago. So whatever you use here, you got to use it up here. So it's one family. It's one thing. It's the whole body. So no one feels neglected.
Great, great. I just have to say, Dr. Sven looks so proud of you, Miss Kimberly. He's so proud. Like he taught you himself.
Makeup and skin go hand in hand. You know that. Yeah.
One thing I do have to say about vitamin E oil is just cautionary with it. Oftentimes people get skin reactions to vitamin E oil, and that can take time for those skin reactions to go in. So if you are one of those people that is using vitamin E oil and you start to develop rashes or bumps or redness kind of it, oftentimes it is to the vitamin E. It's one of those things that people, when they use topically, oftentimes will develop a reaction eventually. For anyone that does use vitamin E oil out there.
Dr. Sven, I have one question. I use Elta MD.
That is my favorite sunscreen in the world.
Oh, awesome.
Writing it down.
I like it.
So that is one that I talked about, is the reflective type of barrier type of sunscreen. So that does have zinc in it. So that does work to kind of reflect the rays. One thing with those, like I talked about in that is one of the ones that has a kind of the finer zinc particles in it, which is okay for some people with more pigmented skin, but some of the darker skin varieties, like my partner has darker skin, sometimes will leave a small white sheen on those. So just, I would say it is a little bit expensive, but if anyone wanted to try that one, I would get a test of it and see if it works well on your skin.
Okay, thank you.
Wonderful. Okay, I know we have a few minutes left. We have something in medicine called a one-liner, and it's where you try to pack in as much information as possible, basically in one sentence. So I know we're running low on time, but if each of you could go around and give the one-liner of what advice you would give to someone with alopecia who's struggling with their own beauty right now, what would you say? And we'll start with, let's start with Dr. Sven.
You know, kind of like I mentioned before, find your internal beauty, find your internal strength, and that will shine through and people will see that. And, you know, if you rock your world as your authentic self, everyone else is going to see that. And that's going to be that's going to be the beauty that people are going to see.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Dr. Sven. Ms. Tony.
I would say just be you, be who you are, accept, embrace yourself. And if people don't like you for who you are, then they're not people that should be around in your life.
Thank you, Miss Tony. Miss Kimberly. Soon to be Mrs. Kimberly.
Well, thank you. But your aura speaks before you do. So make sure you hold your crown high.
Definitely. Miss Yaz.
Good, tell people that it's okay to don't feel okay all the time. There's going to be good days and bad days, and it's fine to be vulnerable and low sometimes, and it's okay to project that on other people. But also, yeah, at the same time, what other people mentioned, just like focus on the things we do have, because hair is probably one of the very few things we do not have. There is loads of things we do have, and that's what gives me my confidence.
Beautiful. Thank you, Miss Yaz. And then finally, Miss Ebony, and then we'll close things out with Renee doing a PowerPoint conclusion for us. Miss Ebony.
There is such a strong community within alopecia. You can connect to so many amazing women just like you. You are not alone. And remember to find the silver lining so you can change up your look. You can wear hair or you can go without it. It just depends on how comfortable you are, but never be afraid to be who you are.
All right, Dr. Renee, it's all you. Just texting Dr. Renee.
I'm gonna call you right back.
Oh yeah, you're good. So just find a good.
Hi everybody. I am wanting to thank everybody for everything. I'm gonna share my screen with you guys really quickly. Well, if I could without sharing Facebook, that would be great.
And this is live. All right.
So this is just us telling you guys thank you. Thank you to NAP just for providing this platform for us to be able to inform our alopecia community about everything that we presented today. Thank you to our panelists for just sharing your story, sharing your expertise with all of us. It's greatly appreciated. I know I took a bunch of notes. I really did, especially with the wigs and the scalp. Really appreciate everything. And I just want to say happy holidays. And to all of you who are seeing this, remember that it is going to be recorded. It will be on the NAP website. This is every one of our experts that we're on today. Here goes their Instagram handles. If you just want to take a screenshot and then just friend them, they are willing to offer you any more advice that you may need. If you need their services, or even if you just need their inspiration, just follow them daily just for it. Also, I can be found on Instagram at Dr. Renee Thomason or on Facebook at Renee Thomason. And Angela can be found at Angie Renee on Facebook and also on Instagram. These are some of our upcoming events that we do have coming up. We have another great alopecia advocate. Her name's Deanne Graham. We'll be on her Alopecia Life podcast on December 21st, where we will talk about basically how Less Talk came about being. Me and Angela will just kind of share more. And then also we'll talk about what will be happening kind of in the new year. Hopefully some fabulous things is happening in January and February. We're just really excited to talk about that. And also we'll be having a man side of alopecia. So we're excited about that. You can find a support group with us. It's on Facebook. It's Less Talk. Open the conversation with alopecia. You can just find us on Facebook there. And like I said, in 2021, we'll have more upcoming webinars. We're just kind of penciling in some dates to match me and Angela's schedule. And then the NAF conference. So you can see that a lot of us, me, Ebony, Angela, we all shared a story just from the NAF conference. I would advocate for anyone that just wants to find support, like a local support group, or just want to know more about alopecia, find out people sharing their stories. You got experts out there from dermatology, just like all over. I would suggest that you just go onto the website. They are doing a a raffle now to where you can kind of put in your name and your information to where you can even go free next year. I believe it's going to be in Denver, Colorado. So we would love to see you there. Also, depending on how the pandemic is, we'll either see you there or on a webinar. So again, thank you guys for participating. Here is our email address, alopeciatalk@gmail.com, or join our Facebook group. But remember also just to contact everyone who was on. So I hope that everybody has a good day and thank you. All right, you guys. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you. Good night. Good night, everybody.
Oh, good night.
See you guys. And thank you again. I appreciate you.
We appreciate you as well.
Yes. Thank you for the opportunity.
Definitely. Bye, Tony.
Bye, Angela. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye. Mm-hmm.